Next on WCW Saturday Night, world champion Ron Simmons answers the challenge of Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff. Hard-hitting heartthrob heavy metal Van Hammer crashes head-on into frightening fruitcake cactus Jack. The international team of young superstars Kensuke Sasaki and Eric Watts test veterans Arn Anderson and stunning Steve Austin. Schlesinger and Shanghai Pierce and Scotty Flamingo show their stuff next on this edition of WCW Saturday Night.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to WCW Saturday Night. I'm Jim Ross. I'll be your host for the next 90 minutes of wrestling action, fans. As you heard, we've got a great broadcast for you here today. But right now, I want to bring out an exciting new team here in WCW. The combination of the Z-Man and Johnny Gunn welcome them to WCW Saturday Night and here at Center Stage. Good to see you guys. Thanks for being here, gentlemen. I tell you what, Tommy, this is a great young man. I'm really excited about the potential of your team.
Excitement's the word. You know, Jim Ross, I'm no stranger to tag team wrestling. I've held several different titles here in World Championship Wrestling, but this young man, Johnny Gunn, has a lot of potential, and we're going to take on any and all comers, world champions. We're going to make our way up that ladder, Jim Ross.
I know that you will, and this is what a great opportunity for you, young man.
Jim Ross, I would like to take this opportunity once to thank WCW for taking a kid off the streets of Philadelphia and making his dream come true. And I'd also like to thank my man right here, the Z-Man, for picking me as his partner, because he could have had his pick of any one of these guys in this organization, but he picked one guy. It was me.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we look forward to great things from this team. But right now, let's go up for action. And our ring announcer, Rhubarb Jones.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing first at 255 pounds from West Palm Beach, Florida, Scotty Flamingo.
Flamingo, 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 Flamingo.
Introducing his opponent already in the ring, he hails from Honolulu, Hawaii, at 231 pounds, Chris Sullivan.
All right, Rhubarb, thanks very much. Scotty Flamingo and Chris Sullivan to kick it off. Fans, we want to send our condolences to the family of Freddie Miller. Freddie, longtime announcer on TBS Wrestling, passed away this past week. And we certainly send our heartfelt condolences to Freddie's family. He certainly will be missed by all of us here at TBS. Chris Sullivan with a side headlock on Scotty Flamingo. And Sullivan with a shoulder block, quickly going for the lateral press. And Flamingo up the quicker of the two, got the flat of the foot in the side of the head of Chris Sullivan. Flamingo, who had that controversial knockout of Johnny B. Badd at the Clash of the Champions, thrown into the ropes, comes off of momentum in the shoulder block. Very fast-paced match here. And Sullivan tried a single leg pickup, but Flamingo ran right through him there. Side headlock takeover, and Scotty Flamingo in control. Fans, don't forget, still to come in this hour. The challenge was answered last week by Ron Simmons. Ron Simmons and the veteran Paul Orndorff, and that matchup still to come in the broadcast. Tremendous move by Sullivan. High hip lock takeover. He hooked the leg. Almost an upset there by a very competitive Chris Sullivan here. He executes a side headlock takeover and got a one count there. Flamingo trying to pull the hair. Did pull the hair, but didn't gain the advantage. Good officiating by Nick Patrick there. Both men back up. Vertical. Waist lock by Flamingo, but it's Sullivan who has control of that side headlock. Flamingo now has countered with that waist lock, cinching it in, but it's Sullivan back with the advantage. Sullivan again, side headlock takeover. Chris Sullivan keeping his game plan very basic, but it has been very effective thus far. Verticality established, but only momentarily. Good counter move by Flamingo. Suplexing Sullivan. And now Scotty Flamingo has the advantage. Tosses Sullivan outside. Certainly causing some separation and I'm sure some disorientation for Sullivan. Flamingo up and over. High risk move. Scotty Flamingo went over the top and landed on Sullivan here. Flamingo so arrogant. Perhaps it's a self-confidence, borderlining certainly on arrogance. Certainly proud of his situation with Johnny B. Badd at the Clash as he snaps Sullivan's neck right across the top ring rope, brings him back in, stomps him in the middle of the back with a flat of the foot. Flamingo in firm control here. Again, flat of the foot, legal maneuvers. And into the neck vise. Sullivan's in the ropes. Flamingo's got to break the hold or be counted out here. Referee reaches five and we'll have a disqualification. Sullivan showing some competitive spirit. Irish whip, that's to the far side. He set way too early. Sullivan set much too early. Lateral press by Flamingo. And Flamingo regaining control here. Mistake made by Sullivan, side headlock takeover. Certainly hope everyone had a great Thanksgiving. And for those of you that attended that wild, crazy event in the Omni on Thanksgiving night, we thank you for your attendance. Great crowd on hand on Thanksgiving night in the Omni. Another shoulder block by Flamingo. On the far side here, leapfrogs over. And Flamingo caught him. No, he didn't. I thought Flamingo, he tried to get the knee up, but it was Sullivan delivering the blow to the midsection and maybe a little bit low inadvertently. In any event, Flamingo makes his way back up. Sullivan could not capitalize on that situation. Sullivan has been very game and competitive here. Flamingo with a knee lift to the solar plexus. And snapmares Sullivan down up on the second rope and drives the fist and forearm right in the face of Chris Sullivan. Flamingo now got him in the pile driver. Flamingo with a pile driver. He hooks the leg and locks the hands. It's over.
The winner of the match, Scotty Flamingo.
So Scotty Flamingo and Johnny B. Badd will soon meet in a rematch. And the self-confident Scotty Flamingo, I understand, will put the gloves on one more time against Johnny B. Badd. There you see the pile driver. Well, as we mentioned, Paul Orndorff said that he had a big surprise for Ron Simmons. I understand Paul is standing by with Tony Schiavone back in the locker room. Tony, take it away.
Okay, Jim, thanks very much, and what a match it will be. The challenge was made last week, and this week it will happen. Ron Simmons against Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff.
Right. You know, Ron Simmons is a great world champion. You know, I said I had a surprise for Ron Simmons.
Exactly.
Medusa, come here. Come here, Medusa.
Medusa, what are you doing here?
Obviously, you don't listen. I told everybody last week what my position is with Rick Rude.
Yeah, what's she doing here?
Let me tell you something, Ron Simmons. When it's all over and done with, I'm going to show you what Mr. Wonderful is all about.
What a match it will be a little bit later on, fans. When we come back on TBS, we'll talk about the King of Cable competition. Stay with us.
Welcome back, everybody, to WCW Saturday Night. Still to come, the Bizarre Cactus Jack goes one-on-one with Heavy Metal Van Hammer. We're going to see that matchup involving the world's heavyweight champion, Ron Simmons, and the challenge with Paul Orndorff with Medusa at ringside. I don't know what's going on here, but we're going to find out later in this hour. Now, we know that the King of Cable Finals will be a part of Starrcade 92, exclusively on pay-per-view Monday, December the 28th. Here's a special feature on the King of Cable Tournament.
Honoring the 20 years of wrestling tradition on TBS, it's the King of Cable Tournament.
WCW promoters with cooperation from WCW Magazine selected 15 of the best athletes. 8 names were randomly drawn to place these 4 matchups. Barry Windham squared off with ravishing Rick Rude. Both men matched up move for move. Windham worked his game plan with moves like this. Rude was able to use some illegal leverage from the ring ropes. Ravishing Rick Rude advances. The second match had Sting against Flyin' Brian. Pillman, with a new attitude, used his refined aerial attack. The long battle ended, with Sting moving on to the next bracket. This contest had 2 of WCW's most powerful men on a collision course. Tony Atlas tested his awesome strength on the mountain-sized man, Big Van Vader. Vader was able to stand rock steady against the strongman. Vader gets a victory. Before his bout with the Barbarian, Dustin Rhodes encountered a major attack from Cactus Jack in his locker room. Officials allowed him time to clear the cobwebs. Dustin battled to the end, keeping his hopes alive to become the King of Cable. In the semifinal round and beyond, 3 judges will decide the outcome of a match if a pinfall does not occur in the allotted time limit. The semifinal round began at Clash of the Champions when Sting met ravishing Rick Rude.
Rude trying to set Sting for the Rude Awakening. He's got it hooked. He's got it nose. Sting able to counter. Sting goes for the Stinger Splash. He hit it. He hit it. Will he have time? There's a Scorpion. Will he have time? He's got it hooked. Oh, no. Time has run out.
We have a split decision. Judge Hiro Matsuda has scored this match in favor of Sting. Judge Larry Zbyszko has scored this match in favor of Ravishing Rick Rude. And the final and deciding ballot to determine which of these wrestlers advance at Starrcade to the finals of the King of Cable, Judge Ole Anderson has scored this for Sting. The winner of the match is
last week in the semifinal match, Dustin Rhodes challenged Big Van Vader.
The winner of the match, Big Van Vader.
So now the final match is set for Starrcade 92 when Sting and Big Van Vader battle to determine the King of Cable.
Sting and Big Van Vader will go one-on-one on Monday, December 28th, exclusively on pay-per-view from Atlanta's Omni in the King of Cable Championship. A lot of things went on this week in the headquarters of WCW. Some new stars talking about coming to World Championship Wrestling to compete. We'll tell you about that until midnight tonight on the Wrestling Hotline. I encourage you to call our hotline until midnight tonight. And when we come back, Cactus Jack will go one-on-one with Heavy Metal Van Hammer. That's next.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a WCW Saturday Night Special attraction. It is scheduled for one fall with a 20-minute time limit. Introducing first, from Truth or Consequences, New Mexico, at 304 pounds, here comes Cactus Jack.
Hammer! Hammer! You're gonna get hurt!
Ladies and gentlemen, making his way into the ring area at 270 pounds from New York City, Heavy Metal Van Hammer.
Heavy Metal Van Hammer gets a great ovation here at Center Stage. Don't forget, fans, we'll be back here at Center Stage this Monday night, 7 o'clock on West Peachtree in Atlanta. Hammer, who's found a lot of success in the WCW Strongest Arm Contest, now going on Worldwide Wrestling meets an old nemesis here in the diabolical and unpredictable Cactus Jack. Collar and elbow tie up to start it off here. Both men vying for position here, and it's Cactus Jack who comes with a fist and the foot right to the midsection, as you can see. Cactus Jack has always been known as a man that will put his own body on the line to do whatever it takes to defeat his opponent. Hammer holds onto that top rope, refuses to be whipped to the other side of the ring. Reverses Cactus Jack. Comes back with those forearms. And Cactus Jack catches Heavy Metal Van Hammer coming in. But Hammer then retaliates with that clothesline and flattens the 300-pounder. And this one has not been scientific whatsoever. Nor, quite frankly, did we think it would be. Cactus Jack now rammed face first into the top turnbuckle. Hammer scoops up the 300-pounder and slams him. And the running knee lift sends Cactus Jack on the outside here. And this is really Cactus Jack's domain. He is extremely dangerous on the outside as he is trying to bring Heavy Metal Van Hammer out here and is successful in doing that. Cactus trying to maul the big man from New York City. Cactus back in the ring. Now that broke the referee's 10 count. That kick caught Hammer right in the abdomen. And then takes him face first into the apron of the ring. Referee Randy Anderson trying to restrain the man from Truth or Consequences, New Mexico. Cactus snapping Hammer's neck across the top ring cable with tremendous torque there. And you see Hammer's face turning bright red. And now Cactus trying again to restrict the breathing of Heavy Metal Van Hammer, and which would obviously slow him down. Hammer fights back. And Cactus with a headbutt. But staggered even Cactus Jack. Cactus again. Putting a hammer across the bottom rope. Cactus Jack drops a leg. Oh, what an unorthodox move by Cactus Jack. A leg drop right on out here on the apron. And Hammer in severe trouble as Cactus kicks him right in the face. Cactus Jack is manhandling Heavy Metal Van Hammer here. The whip. And Hammer just barely able to get out of the corner. Still made some contact with Cactus. Cactus Jack snapmares him over. And Cactus Jack now making Heavy Metal Van Hammer carry that additional weight. And as Cactus has that reverse chin lock again, crimping the neck and obviously making it very difficult for Heavy Metal Van Hammer to take deep breaths. Fatigue factor got to be setting in here as Cactus has really controlled it physically, making Hammer carry that additional weight as we look into the face of the madman from New Mexico. Missing a couple of front teeth. And the look of determination by Heavy Metal Van Hammer trying to, he's got to find a way to get back to a vertical base. That's what he's doing now, turning into the pressure. Hammer, elbow and Cactus, caught him in the midsection. The Cactus fights back with a straight right hand. Hammer caught him in the right, that caught Cactus on the jaw. Caught him one more time, walking in. Three big time right hands by Heavy Metal Van Hammer. And Cactus now is reeling from this offensive onslaught. Hammer set a little early. Cactus capitalized, got that big left foot in there. Here comes that clothesline, and they both go over and down to the concrete floor here at center stage. Cactus Jack apparently willing, well, I thought he was, I was going to say willing to settle for a count out victory, but he stops the referee's count momentarily. And hammers him all! Good grief! The splat of Cactus Jack! Echo, this head just bounced off the floor. Hammer being followed by Cactus Jack back in. And now, is this the opportunity that Hammer can capitalize on? What a counter move, suplexing Cactus on the concrete floor. Hammer going up top here, and Cactus follows him up. I'm not so sure that this was a very wise move, but Hammer able to capitalize, make an adjustment in the air to find himself on top. Oh, he drove the clothesline in the back of the head. Cactus face at the turnbuckle. Hammer drops the knee of the leg right across the face, hooks the leg, and he's gonna win it.
The winner of the contest, Heavy Metal Van Hammer.
What a hard-fought victory here for Heavy Metal Van Hammer. Fans, don't forget tomorrow we start our look at 1989, that championship year. And we'll be back with the Starrcade Control Center next.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing first with a combined weight of 550 pounds from Amarillo, Texas, the team of Tex Schlesinger and Shanghai Pierce.
Shanghai Pierce with that hook 'em horn sign, the sign of the University of Texas.
This is it right here.
Introducing their opponents with a combined weight of 443 pounds, the team of Ian Weston and Rex Cooper.
Rex Cooper on your left, Ian Weston on your right to challenge big rugged team from West Texas. Tex Schlesinger and the masked man, Shanghai Pierce. And don't forget, still to come, the world's heavyweight champion Ron Simmons in that special challenge event with Paul Orndorff. Medusa will be with Orndorff, and you gotta know that somewhere Ravishing Rick Rude is keenly aware of this entire situation. Because I know Rude is very possessive and very protective of Medusa. That's still to come here on WCW Saturday night. Collar and elbow tie up. It's Weston and Shanghai Pierce starting it out for their respective teams. And the big masked man certainly not giving Weston the opportunity for a clean break there, but Weston catches him coming in. Ian Weston is an outstanding competitor who's got to use his quickness and speed here. And that's what they're doing now. They're striking a great deal of suddenness on Shanghai Pierce. And look at Pierce walk around the ring to his side of the ring, basically, to return. Very subtle move, but a very intelligent one. Perhaps would go unnoticed. Good drop toe hold. Floats over, side headlock. He's trying to get the side headlock there. And Shanghai Pierce quickly back up to a vertical base with a waist lock, and Weston tags in his partner, Rex Cooper. Cooper maintains control with the side headlock. Good agility there. And Cooper takes down Shanghai Pierce. Cooper again makes the tag to Ian Weston. It's not bad teamwork by Weston and Cooper. High elevation. Good double team offense there as they took advantage of the referee's count. Side headlock takeover. And pinning predicament there by Shanghai Pierce. When a wrestler makes a tag, he's got a count of five to leave the ring. So you see a lot of things take place between or before the referee gets to his five count, and that's exactly what they use there, that count to their advantage. Uh-oh. Shanghai Pierce caught him in midair and then just tried to break his back with a backbreaker, lateral press, and Ian Weston now in trouble. He's got to use quickness again to make the tag, and we take our first look at Big Tex Slashinger. Rick in the eyes, this team, reminiscent of a wild team out of West Texas known as the Texas Outlaws. Dick Murdoch and Dusty Rhodes, close to 20 years ago when they were doing some head busting. And there was a tag, so Weston makes the tag to Cooper. And now let's see if Cooper can reestablish some offense. It's slashing to Rick in the eyes. Powerful slam there. And now Slashinger makes the exchange with Shanghai Pierce, who keeps the focus on the mid-back area. Got him up. Suplex. Cooper now got to be feeling a great deal of pain in his lower back. High elbow. The elbow drop. This could be all. And he got him right there. Pierce and Slashinger win it here. Hey, they've got a darn good one-loss record here in the last several weeks. So, well, they want to say something. What's going on here? I'm not sure that mic's even on.
First of all, I want you people to shut up and listen to what I have to say.
Well, he's rather emotional.
Hey, we haven't been here very long, but you people know what we're about. We're about Texas. And Texas doesn't quit. And Texas never backs down from a challenge. You got a couple pretty boys out here throwing challenges around like they were free. While they were spending time in the tanning beds and oiling each other up. But in Shanghai, we're roping and riding and fighting. And they got the guts. If you got the guts to take us on, climb up there, boy.
Listen, you two big mouths from Texas are just new around here, and Z-Man and Johnny Gunn aren't saying, listen, all you gotta do, big boy, can you sign your name on the dotted line? Are you that intelligent anytime, anywhere?
Oh, he hit him right in the face and brings Z-Man in. Pierce hammering away at Johnny Gunn as well. The fight has started. Z-Man with a super kick and outside goes Tex. The referees are now trying to restore some order here. A double drop kick. The masked man up and over the top. Oh, it's exploded here on WCW Saturday night. What a situation, fans. We'll be back.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is your WCW Saturday Night semifinal bout. One fall with a 20-minute time limit. Introducing first with a combined weight of 509 pounds from Hollywood, California, stunning Steve Austin and his partner from the state of Minnesota, Arn Anderson. They're coming to the ring by Paul E. Dangerously.
What a tag team matchup this should be, ladies and gentlemen. Don't forget, next week we've got tag team action. Sting and Ron Simmons will take on Big Van Vader and Ravishing Rick Rude here next Saturday night. Austin, a lot of confidence with Arn Anderson. Back to Rhubarb.
Introducing their opponents with a combined weight of 501 pounds from Tokyo, Kensuke Sasaki, and from the University of Louisville, Eric Watts.
Eric Watts, who attended the University of Louisville, is actually from Bixby, Oklahoma. Kensuke Sasaki, one of the great young stars internationally. We've seen him here on many occasions. He's always one of the most promising young athletes in Japan, with one of the most promising young athletes here in the United States. Eric, as we have seen, has been training with these great Japanese stars, learning some tremendous submission maneuvers, specifically the STF, the step over toe hold with a cross face, a combination submission move that puts tremendous torque on your knee. Austin and Sasaki starting it out, and you can see Sasaki is a real powerhouse, low center of gravity, hard to move around physically to overpower him, I should say. Side headlock applied to stunning Steve Austin. Good shoulder block by Sasaki. And Austin caught it coming off the ropes. Good move by Austin. Right hand. Now Austin with the advantage here. Says he's outsmarted Sasaki. Caught him with the elbow now in the back of the head. And Austin, he took too much time there. Good counter into the back body drop by Sasaki. Irish whips him into the near side turnbuckle. He caught him with a clothesline. Oh, he caught him with a tremendous clothesline. Sasaki perhaps should have gone for the lateral press there or a pinning predicament, but he tags in Eric Watts. And Watts comes in. Off the top rope, that double axe handle right on the tricep of stunning Steve Austin. Now hammers down on it with a forearm. But Austin with a counter, taking Eric to the corner, but nobody there. Makes the tag to Arn Anderson. Anderson, dropped toe hold. Watts with the advantage. And drops a knee right into the quadricep muscle, that thigh muscle, as it inserts with the knee, putting a great deal of pressure on the knee there by on Anderson. And Anderson able to kick him outside. Watts was going for that, looked like the spinning toe hold, which is the prelude into the complete STF submission maneuver. Eric back up on the turnbuckle. Oh, he caught Anderson in the face with that knee. Got the knee up. Anderson's a little dazed there. Eric goes up and over the top. Anderson is down. And a near fall by Watts on Anderson. Anderson back up. Single leg pickup and a tag made. Sasaki makes the exchange with Watts. And here we see some double team offense. They've got to be out before the referee counts five. And they will do that. Indeed, also doing some damage to the knee of Arn Anderson. Sasaki kicking violently at that hamstring, plus it and the knee as well, and makes another tag. Boy, this is a team of Sasaki and Watts looking very crisp here. Sasaki has more experience than does Watts, and you know there's a language problem there as well. But they certainly are showing some good teamwork. Anderson trying to fight to his corner as it has Watts back heel trip, takes him back down. Sasaki and Watts have combined to really focus on the knee and the leg of Arn Anderson, stretching the hamstring there. Another single leg takedown. Very pugnacious-like move, and now what's Sasaki going to try to do? Looks could be a half Boston Crab if he turns him all the way over. Paulie dangerously very concerned about what he is seeing here. There is a half Boston Crab, a submission move. Anderson trying to stay up on one shoulder, finally reaches for the bottom rope. There you see that, and the referee will break the hold. Tag has been made. And again, you see some outstanding teamwork by Watts and Sasaki. Another quick tag. You've got to be impressed by the frequency of the tags of Watts and Sasaki. Sasaki and Anderson just made a great counter move. He used his free leg to make the counter and tag in stunning Steve Austin. And now Anderson holds Sasaki down while Austin comes in and stomps away. That was a great tag team move by Arn Anderson, able to make the counter. Anderson's knee got to be tightening up on him, one would assume. High impact elbow to the back of the head. Dangerously confers with Anderson on the outside. about his physical status. As you see, great suplex by stunning Steve Austin. Austin with that knee right into the spine. And again, one more time. High impact, may have got him in the kidneys there. Austin, you heard him say, "Are you all right?" before he made the tag. Anderson said yes. Anderson, though he's limping, that may not have been a good tag, in as much as Anderson, who wants to compete, obviously. Hey, he's a stallion, there's no doubt about that. But he may have needed to take a little more time on the outside. Time will tell as this one progresses. Caught him with the elbow. And you see Anderson, he knew he wasn't ready to come back. He got back on the outside after the tag. It's gonna take some more time for Anderson. And Sasaki with that chop. Sasaki with another chop. Austin with the right hand on Watts on the outside. Inside cradle, Sasaki, can he hold him? No, he got two, a long two. And Austin very quickly back up to his feet. He was up much quicker than Sasaki. And Austin drives the elbow into the back of Sasaki, and once again, tags in Arn Anderson. Anderson noticeably limping here, as we know from the clash, has had some problems with his knee. Oh, what a move! What a move by Kintsugi Sasaki! What a martial arts kick! And Anderson able to make the tag, but so does Sasaki. Austin and Watts in there now. Austin misses a clothesline, but Watts does not. Eric slamming Anderson, who had yet not left the ring. Irish whip, going left to right on your television screen. Good hip lock. Taylor, gosh, he caught him and drove him face first. Watts head snaps back, and Austin catches him with that running forearm. Watts in a lot of trouble here. Austin now clearly in control of this tag team matchup. Gaining an unfair advantage here. And referee Nick Patrick having some words and restraining Sasaki, while Anderson able to take that opportunity to snap Eric's neck off the top rope. Austin lateral press, hooked the near leg, and got a near fall out of it. Another tag made. Watson is being really tested here. Irish whip, Anderson got all he could in that Irish whip and takes him back again. Anderson going to that front face lock, perhaps trying to go for DDT here. Watts trying to fight for the corner. Anderson nails Sasaki, so he can't be in a position to make the tag. Front face lock by Double A. And Anderson now using his mass and his strength to prevent Watts from making a tag. Anderson keeping his body between Watson and Eric's partner. Oh, and there's a tag. Sasaki in now. Sasaki on fire here, nailing stunning Steve Austin. Sasaki having some words with the referee. I don't understand that. The referee's putting Austin outside. And apparently the referee's not going to allow the tag. Well, I don't understand that, quite frankly. And Anderson, I can't understand the DDT. They're going to try to finish off Eric Watts right here. Anderson, he went for the knee drop, but Eric moved out of the way. And now here comes Austin across to attack Sasaki. Eric driving Anderson's knee down. And he's going for it. He's going for it. He's got the STF. He's got it. He's got it right there. Anderson, will he submit? We've never seen him submit before. He's going to tear that knee. Eric is going to tear the knee. He's caught up for it. Anderson gives it up. Watts is going to win it for his team with the STF. The STF was the deciding factor. What a submission move. And Watts and Sasaki have upset Anderson and Austin here.
And Eric Watts.
Anderson's knee was hurt, and Watts capitalized on the situation. Here you see it. Perfect application of the STF, the step over toe hold, dropped in into the cross face, pulling back on the neck, but the pressure is ripping at those ligaments and that cartilage. Watts and Sasaki win it, and we'll be back right after this. Welcome back, everyone, to WCW Saturday Night. Thanks very much for being with us here again. Now, don't forget to join me tomorrow night on AM 750 WSB. We'll be taking your telephone calls. I'm sure a lot of you are going to talk about Starrcade 92 coming to Atlanta's Omni on Monday, December 28th, exclusively on pay-per-view. We've also got an outstanding broadcast for you tomorrow at 6:05 here on TBS, the main event. Hope you'll join us for that one as well. Now, our colleague Tony Schiavone recently caught up with the Vice President of Wrestling Operations for WCW, Cowboy Bill Watts. Here's how that conversation went.
Welcome back to WCW Up Close, and I'm very happy to be talking with the Executive Vice President, the man in charge of Wrestling Operations with World Championship Wrestling, Cowboy Bill Watts. And Bill, thanks a lot for your time. A lot of questions going on in World Championship Wrestling. I wanted to ask you to maybe address some of the issues for us. We saw not too long ago, as a matter of fact, last week right here on WCW Saturday Night, after a brawl, Sting came out with a 2x4, broke it over the back of Big Van Vader. What do you think about that?
Well, two things, Tony. First of all, people are always asking me, when are you going to clean up WCW, or when are you going to stop all the things that happened? You can make all the rules and regulations you want, and you can't stop or totally control an emotional sport like wrestling, like pro football, like ice hockey, like anything else. So I don't advocate that Sting use a 2x4. However, I've often used in this example Dusty Rhodes, myself, Ole Anderson, Thunderbolt Patterson, okay. All the great wrestlers of the past certainly didn't go cry to the officials and the referees to handle their dirty work for them. So sometimes you got to fight fire with fire. And I guarantee you, Vader and all the things they've done to Sting, I think he's about up to here. And I was really glad to see him break out and really go ballistic a little bit and take matters in his own hand. I guess I have to be. You know, years ago, I walked tall with a 2x4 also. Right. And it's pretty dadgum effective.
Well, Vader has been involved with many things. He broke the back of young Joe Thurman. Many people have written in to say, how can a guy like this continue to compete in World Championship Wrestling doing things like that? And I'm sure he's lost a great deal of money because of his actions.
Well, first of all, it was a legal maneuver, the powerbomb.
That's right.
He was in a handicap match. He was against two guys.
Right.
Injuries happen. You know, I remember Fred the Hammer Williams when he played for the Oakland Raiders. He was an intimidator. And I know down deep, whenever he put somebody out of commission, he wasn't gloating over the fact their career was over. But the tough hit, when you're full of that adrenaline, and that's your job, right. You certainly get excited about it. And when you're an intimidator, you're not going to back down and apologize on public TV. I know Big Vader, certainly he's not proud of Joe Thurman's injury, mm-hmm. but when he gave him that powerbomb and put him away, he's not going to back off from it either. Just like, you know, the injuries to Joe Theismann or to Utley or all these different guys that get right. hurt, the guy that does it to him doesn't want it to be a career-ending injury. Mm-hmm. But when you're pumped full of adrenaline, it's a contact sport, and you're wanting to whack them good and hard, you're so exhilarated that when you do something really cold, hard, and crisp, it excites you.
Speaking of intimidators, one of the biggest intimidators in WCW has to be Ravishing Rick Rude. And basically, what I want you to talk about is the situation going on between Rude and your son, Eric. Just last week, he made the challenge to Eric, and he's made it personal between himself and the Watts family. What's your feeling on this whole situation?
Well, unfortunately, you can't divorce the two. My son, Eric, who came into pro wrestling, is getting a lot of heat from a lot of sources, a lot of it because of me. Right. But he's had to deal with that his entire life. If I was just directing his career, I would not want him to take on somebody like Rude yet. I just don't think it's quite time. He doesn't have the experience. But I can't protect him, and I'm not the one that's directing his career. We have a booking committee. And I want to say one thing. I don't think Eric really would go out and seek Rick Rude, because Rick Rude is one of the top wrestlers in the world today. However, Eric is not going to back down. And when you're called out, you may as well go step forward and try them on. They still put their pants on one leg at a time. Yeah, some of them are a heck of a lot tougher, but you got to get into it. You got to be there. If you can't stand the heat, get out of the kitchen. So as a father, yes, I'm concerned for Eric because I don't want him to get a career-ending injury because of the animosity developed by these other guys. But I'll say another thing. Do you think Rick Rude or anybody would cut anybody any slack that they thought was a rookie? Do you think they'd give them any break? They're like wolves out there, right. And they're preying on the weaker. So it's the law of survival in professional sports. And if Eric's going to survive, he's got to kick it in gear.
Okay, one final question for you. We're in the midst of a tremendous youth movement in world championship wrestling with Eric, with Dustin Rhodes, with this youngster Too Cold Scorpio. Why the youth movement in world championship wrestling, Bill?
Well, when I came back to wrestling, most of the stars in professional wrestling were stars when I sold my business. Right. Most of the stars for the WWF and most of the stars here. And they're great athletes, but it's just like any other team, like a team in the NFL. When it gets to where all of its stars have been around for a long, long time, they sometimes get kind of set in their ways, they get a comfort zone, and they also, it gets a little bit stale. One thing about it, people want to see what's new and different. There hasn't been a lot of new in wrestling, and I think youth has always got to be integrated into whatever you have. They've got to be thrown in there. They've got to realize that if they can knock some of these top guys off, it creates an opportunity for them to become the star. Where were all these guys 9, 10 years ago that are the stars of today? They were climbing and clawing their way to the top. Right. Now they've been there a long time. I think it's great to have some people that haven't had the opportunity to be exposed and to be shown and to give, given the chance to try to move up and take those top positions. And I think all the fans at home are going to be the beneficiary of all this action with these fresh people.
Okay, Bill, listen, thanks a lot for your time.
Well, thank you, Tony.
All right, Bill Watts on WCW Up Close.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is your WCW Saturday Night Main Event, a special challenge match scheduled for one fall with a 20-minute time limit. Introducing first from Tampa, Florida, at 242 pounds, Paul Orndorff. He's accompanied to the ring by Medusa.
Well, that's his surprise. We heard that earlier in the program down in the locker room. But I don't like the looks of this situation. Where Medusa goes, so does Ravishing Rick Rude.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing at 275 pounds, from Warner Robins, Georgia, the WCW World Heavyweight Champion, Ron Simmons!
Big Ron Simmons with a great ovation here on WCW Saturday Night. Simmons and Ravishing Rick Rude have signed to meet in the Omni in Atlanta on Monday night, December the 28th. As a part of Starrcade 92, which will be exclusively on pay-per-view. But Paul Orndorff, who, as I mentioned last week, has been competing a great deal around the world in many different areas, including Smoky Mountain Wrestling, where he's got a tremendous feud with Ron Garvin. Came here last week, wanted to challenge Simmons. Simmons accepted. So here we are. But again, the situation with Medusa here has me personally very uncomfortable. But Simmons is a competitor, and Orndorff, Mr. Wonderful, having some very stern words with some of our great fans here at Center Stage. We'll be back here at Center Stage this Monday night at 7, by the way. Well, I've seen Orndorff compete since he left the University of Tampa, where he was an outstanding running back. Collar and elbow tie-up. Orndorff forces the world's heavyweight champion back into the corner, but it's Ron Simmons reversing it here. And we get a good sportsmanlike break from the Warner Robins, Georgia native and former Florida State All-American Ron Simmons. Simmons extremely, extremely intense. But he has got to be very, very careful, the man, with the physical skills and the experience of Mr. Wonderful. Orndorff comes with that four and catches Simmons. Simmons reaching for the ropes there. High impact moves by Paul Orndorff, one of the most intense competitors you'll find. Again, his forearms find this mark, and now the right hand catches Simmons right on the jaw, and Simmons is in a dazed state here. Orndorff for the knee to the midsection. Simmons trying to fight back, but it's Orndorff with a rake to the eyes. not allowing Simmons the opportunity to gain any momentum. Irish whip. It will be reversed. Oh, a lot of impact there. Hip hop takeover. The world's heavyweight champion with a drop kick. And down goes Paul Orndorff. In this special challenge event, football tackle, lateral press, the leg hook, and a near fall. Oh, what action. Steamboat, or excuse me, Simmons again. Football block, and Orndorff able to get his hands in the bottom ropes. Ah, this one really exploded there. What an offensive flurry. And Ron Simmons with a succession of near falls, and Orndorff was really reeling. And now backs away, slows it down a little bit. Another collar and elbow tie up. And Simmons with the advantage into the first the wrist lock and the hammer lock and drives the upper arm of Orndorff into the top turnbuckle. And you hear the fans here in the background, that Florida State Seminole chant. Simmons with a arm barred. Well, Orndorff got some good leverage, but Simmons relentless there, held on very pugnaciously. Headbutt by the world's heavyweight champion into the tricep of Paul, Mr. Wonderful Orndorff. Keeping the pressure on the arm bar, or with the arm bar. Orndorff finally gets Simmons back into the turnbuckle. We'll get a break here. Oh, but not a clean one. Orndorff with those knees into the midsection. Look at Simmons trying to fight out of that corner. Simmons, Irish whip. Oh, gosh, he caught him right on the elbow in the face. Orndorff got the elbow in the face of the world's champion. There's a modified suplex. And Orndorff driving the point of his elbow right into the chest of Simmons. Again, and dangerously near the throat there goes the elbow of Mr. Wonderful. Flat of the foot right to the face. Paul Orndorff now building some momentum. Looking very impressive here. He made the challenge here last week. Good drop kick. Orndorff now going for the lateral press and near fall. Orndorff has been a tremendous competitor in his career, as I mentioned. He started wrestling for Cowboy Bill Watts in the Mid-South wrestling area not too long after he left the University of Tampa, where he was an outstanding running back. I think he played there with Freddie Solomon some years ago. Orndorff has headlined wrestling events around the world, including one in the Sky Dome in Toronto, where over 70,000 people attended. And he has neutralized the strength and power of the world's champion, using his knee as a block there in the spine and that reverse chin lock. So the power of Ron Simmons has been negated here through the technique and leverage exercised by Paul Orndorff. Again, Medusa is at ringside. And that is the secret weapon of Orndorff. As there you see Medusa in the right part of your screen. But as I mentioned, I know that Ravishing Rick Rude, we've seen it on many occasions, very, very possessive of what he calls his woman. But we know that she is the director of covert operations. So her association with Orndorff is somewhat dubious. Both men back up to vertical base. Look at the power of Simmons. There's where the power comes in. Football block, lateral press, near fall. Simmons almost able to get a three count out of it, but Orndorff able to beat his opponent back up. Oh, he dropped the knee right to the face. He dropped the knee right to the face. And now with a head scissors. And Orndorff able to use the ropes there to assist him in holding Simmons down. And it's not as if he's going to admit it, ref. Orndorff, being the veteran that he is, obviously knows every trick in the old proverbial book. Simmons, he's got to get back up vertical here and be able at least to get into a position to use his power. We know his power slam is, when it's executed correctly, is beyond compare. But Orndorff is wrestling a very smart and a very aggressive match here. Those kicks to the head are legal, using the flat of the foot. Irish whip. Oh, Orndorff went for the drop kick, and Simmons able to make a U-turn. High impact clothesline by the world's heavyweight champion. Special challenge event. In case you just joined us here on WCW Saturday night, as Simmons comes with the right hands. Irish whip, elbow. A lot of power being exhibited by the world champion. Lateral press. And here the referee said he was in the ropes. Raking the eyes again by Orndorff. And Simmons has not been able to maintain control for any extended length of time in this matchup. And he caught him with a slam. He caught him with a power slam. El Medusa slapped him in the face. And Simmons relinquishes the hold. And Medusa slapped the champion in the face, and Simmons not going to stand for that. Here comes Rude. There's Rude. And Simmons nails ravishing Rick Rude and knocks him down. Here comes Orndorff from behind, but Simmons nails him too. Ravishing Rick Rude just got the taste knocked out of his mouth, but Orndorff was waiting on Simmons as the champion came back into the ring. Simmons reverses the Irish whip. Oh, well, Orndorff inadvertently ran into the referee. Referee is down. There's a slam by Simmons, who misses the elbow. Rude is just now getting up. Side headlock there. And, oh, they collide. Orndorff and Simmons collide. Wait a minute, here comes Rude. Ravishing Rick Rude has him up. Not the pile drop. Oh, no. Oh, no. He dropped him right on his head on the concrete. Ravishing Rick Rude with a pile driver. He has dropped Ron Simmons on the concrete here, and the referee did not see it. You see the position of the referee. Orndorff is still groggy. He's finally back up. Orndorff wants the referee to count. Orndorff may win it by count out here. Rude with a pile driver. Viciously driving Simmons' head into the floor. And Orndorff's going to win it by count out. Well, thanks to ravishing Rick Rude, Orndorff upsets the world's champion. Simmons is hurt. Fans, will be back. Oh, Ron's hurt. We'll be back after this. Don't go away.
Ladies and gentlemen, as you all know, Ravishing Rick Rude and Ron Simmons just 30 days away at Starrcade for the heavyweight championship of the world. We know that. But why attack the world's champion in this match with Paul Orndorff?
You know, Ross, the man learned to roam the streets at night. He learned how to and he learned how to fight in the ghetto. But one thing that Ron Simmons did not learn in the ghetto was that you don't touch Ravishing Rick Rude's property. You keep your hands off from my woman. Tonight, Jim Ross, Ron Simmons was taught a valuable lesson. Now, 30 days from today, Starrcade 92, once again, Ron Simmons will be forced to visit the School of Hard Knocks. And once again, Ron Simmons, Ravishing Rick Rude will teach you a very valuable lesson. Ron Simmons, what's mine is mine,
and what's yours will be mine. See you at Starrcade.
And fans, we will see you tomorrow on the main event. For everyone here at TBS, good night, everybody.